Thank you, Alan, for inviting me to our event here. I recognize some of them. We have a panel on Boston, the understanding of the Boston workshop perspective. Is this already here on level learning before? Thank you. But for the benefit of those who have never learned in the book, I want to make it clear at the outset that what I am going to share with you. What I'm going to share with you is an experience of all human beings, which shared the level of being on one of the fundamental basis to compare and adjust and to see if there's any significant element in those experiences that we both can take advantage of. I'm not going to present a particular philosophy or a particular system or a particular dogma. Or religion, or cult, or anything from the occult, or a particular psychological operation. What I'm going to suggest to you is that there are some simple truths that come on the way, and if we look at those truths objectively for our own good, they can be very helpful in the story, and in the real life we are not, even in the life we are. So it's a simple sharing of experiences. And I share it with you for whatever work it is. And you have to determine for yourself if there is any relevance in what I am stating here or what I am sharing with you. Relevance, they don't like. If it has a relevance, then this lecture today would have been worthwhile. And if it is irrelevant, then we can be wasted on the time. Some people are making this clear, let's not think that I have come up with some great philosophies and presupposed ideas, and if you have to examine them from the point of view of a particular philosophy angle, and they are going to examine any philosophy you have, any point of view you have, any responses and reaction that you may have. So let us make it an interactive kind of program for today. Also, you are free. To interact with me at any time you like, in order to get clarification on what I am saying, in order to make me repeat what I am saying because of my different accent coming from another subcontinent, another continent, and you can interact with me to make a point which you feel is strong enough and which I might be missing out on. So you are free to use this as a discussion group rather than merely a ritual. Presenting a new point of view to a different audience. That's not the goal of my visit here. So, with this introductory remark, I proceed to see what I have to say. This is more or less in the nature of modern thinking on the subject of spiritual pursuits versus worldly pursuits. First of all, I would like to have my opinion on this subject, namely, how many of you think that spiritual pursuits are a separate thing from worldly pursuits in these events? They are two different things. Thank you. How many of you think that spiritual pursuits are the same as worldly pursuits? Thank you. So, we have, and how many of you have decided about it? Thank you. That is the best group we will get. We are all decided to represent the majority of those who express their opinion. And those who are not muttered are still under the result. So there are those who are not even muttered at this time, whether they are indeterminate, or whether they take a wrong position, or they are not muttered. So they are really on the right. How many of you support the muttered? So this is whatever comes. That's the overwhelming result. Thank you. That's the kind of group I love to talk to, to share my views with. This open-mindedness. Because unfortunately for most of us, our upbringing, our educational system, our process of civilization often conditions us to take certain stance, take certain attitude, take up a certain position, sometimes subconsciously, unconsciously, sometimes consciously, and we feel threatened if a different point of view comes up before us, and we want to be sure. There's nothing wrong going on here. I know I was talking so beautifully about the greatness of God once, and I think there were lights from all the churches nearby sitting there. They come and speak in the say our souls. Maybe they can come home. How could a person discuss God in such obvious beauty and so sweet in the consciousness and in the process of life? They thought it was all the blessings. From their standpoint, it was, I was saying too much in praise of God. It was not what they thought should be the appropriate place. They had the appropriate place to come in the earlier recorded words which are acceptable to them. So I can see how much confusion can go into us that we are not open to anything. Well, this is a good audience, and I hope nobody gets this feeling that we are willing to discuss some of yesterday's book, the satanic verses, or we are going to understand every verse, or we will practice any of those things. No, we are concerned with any of those things. We are concerned with ourselves. We are concerned with our own consciousness and our active life as we live in this world. When we are going through life in this world, we are struck by the differences in the lifestyle of different people. Some are rich and famous, having a grand time, a lot of money, and very little work to do, enjoying themselves, and some are working very hard, trying to make enough to survive. Some are wearing excellent clothes, some are in bands, some are living in African countries, some are surrounded in third world countries, and they're all human beings. What makes all these differences? How come some people are getting the better of this life and some are not? How are they set up like this? Are we the creation of some outside power that believes so strongly in discrimination between one human being and another as to not allow equality at all? Or are we the product of our own actions? We ourselves created our conditions here. And if so, where did we go? Should we believe in afterlives and karma? Should we believe that we had an opportunity to set up our destiny when we came to this life? And do we have a rich and poor? Or should we believe that this is the only life we have? And we are all born equal, but somehow something is going wrong, that someone has an advantage and others don't. Is it a mistake? Is it a delay? These are the first questions that arise that we want to understand how to proceed with our many results at this side of the world. Then we walk. If we are all unequal, who is responsible? Is there some strange law operating that we don't understand? Is this some way to understand it? This question has been posed for centuries. I know who was born in the Vedic world. I have written history books of various kinds, including scriptures, written centuries ago, that people have asked this question. We refer to the Bible, with which many of you may be familiar. Jesus was asked when a boy and blind child was presented to him. Master, is my child blind because of his actions or the actions of his father? Because if he's born blind, he can go blind to that. Is it his father responsible for his blindness or is he responsible for his blindness? And Jesus answers, according to the record available in the Bible, Jesus said, either is this child blind because of his actions, or is he blind because of his father's actions, he is blind so that the law may be given. Under very some of you are writers. Which law? What kind of law has to be given to allow for these things to happen that right from the birth? The child is born blind. Another one, all the pregnant and precautious. one is made successful when he's created, and one is not made successful when he's created. Where do they get answers to these questions? What law is creating to give this kind of a high spike and this kind of a word one time and another kind of another time? Many people have tried to find answers from speculation. But there is a group of people who believe in personal introspection, in personal realization, in self-realization, who want to find the answers within their own consciousness. These adepts, these experts in consciousness, who want to get the answers from within themselves, they have done some experiments by which they can have access to their own higher self, to their own higher conscious self. And it is their claim that by having access to our own higher self, we can get answers to these questions. Their proposition is that you can, if you have the desire and the will to do it, have access to your own higher self within yourself to get the answers to these questions. Their statement is, do not believe what people say. Do not have blind faith in any state, but have living faith of your own experience within your own self. So there is a good proposition which appeals to us that if we can find the true answer within ourselves, then we find it. So they are not suggesting that you blindly accept something. They are suggesting you experiment with your own source of knowledge, your own source of awareness, and see if you can find the answers. They say that they convince these experiments after they have been successful. While they are not successful, they say it with other babies, perhaps, but once they get it, they seem to change their side. And they speak as if they got it and they don't know the change they get. It is almost like they speak with the follower of somebody who is not enlightened. Like we hear Jesus Christ speaking on the mount as having spoken after the realization and frankly, when he spoke, he didn't say so and so says this, therefore I'm saying it. You notice this sermon on the mount, it doesn't contain any such phrase. He speaks directly, this is it, this is it. And what does the record indicate? After he spoke, the Bible says, there was a hush upon the multitude. For he spoke like one with knowledge and not like the scribes. He was different from the others because he spoke like he knew. And therefore, these experimenters say, if you are able to know, know directly, rather than what you have heard from us. But their attention is not merely on a particular thing to understand from us. Their attention is on the current possibilities that exist in human consciousness. They tell us that you are in this world and are living a really pattern. I doubt if it is something as an infinite pattern also. It is a worldly pattern. You born in certain parents, you born in a particular location, apparently not of your choice. And that takes you off in a particular kind of lifestyle, and you then follow that lifestyle as your worldly pursuits, and you carry on. And sometimes it is just a bad place, it does not give you time to question and say, what am I doing? You just have to keep on doing to survive, and go through various stages of life, the body goes forward. Or until that time, this is already pursued. The consequence that takes you from birth to death has given you no time to pause if there is any other section of a conscious experience which you missed out on. It looks like most people spend their time attending to this other place in worldly pursuits right from childhood up to old age and death. That they consider that they have no time for anything else. I have found people who are very busy, they have no time. People who are doing nothing have no time. People who are on vacation have no time. Nobody has time. All busy. Sometimes they are rehearsing and they have no time for rehearsing. Or when I said, I really love to have a kind of job where I have nothing to do for half the day, that's afterwards. You know, this country will bring us so many people. As if mere existence is good enough, it's all. And all the attention of all these people is constant, you know, what is behind them? Who is my friend? Who is my relative? Who am I married? Who are my children? Who are my parents? What obligations do I have to them? What relationships do I have? I need to be lonely. How do I overcome my loneliness? Who should I meet? Who should I cultivate? All the attention is drawing from that individual outward to building up these relationships and acquiring these experiences with people, things, circumstances around them. Does anybody stop and say, I spent all my time getting all my attention from this head, from this brain of mine, to all this thing around me? Have I given any attention to who's doing this inside? Where is this coming from? Is this something inside? Is this clicking and giving me all this external experience? Or is there nothing inside? Well, one pauses to look at what is happening inside. One is smiling. One closes one's eyes, introspection, looks at oneself, and finds the amazing thought that everything outside is happening because of what was happening. As if we are for you, and I am destined for this life from the time of birth and the time of death, in consciousness, in mind, before we are for you. How do we find out when we walk inside our own head and look at our own consciousness? We do not. I have sometimes asked people who for the first time perhaps and look at themselves inside and say, did you find it interesting? Is that interesting? We have actually told you. We actually told us. We have been 20 years old, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 100 years old. We have actually told us that there is something to look inside. So, did you ever hear that this army is a temple? Living God? Isn't it striking? I don't look inside this temple and see God living in it. Isn't that as good as good for building up faith? That's good for building up love for people in compassion. Did you believe it? Well, we tried a lot of people, but we are so terrible. The world is getting more terrible. We are going down here. Everybody is now operating busy for everybody else. It's an anchor for you. Violence, aggression. Everything is going wrong. Did you check inside or going outside? Suppose most of the time you are also looking for time for inside. You are going inside. People talk about the meditation, and people talk about awakening, and people talk about the secret mind and consciousness within. People talk about yoga, and samadhi. But those things are not for us. We try, we close our eyes, it's all dark inside. We don't have nothing to find inside. Then they say, like, yeah, immediately I heard of the story of that old woman in the village, Indian village. There is no electricity, and the only lights are the street lamps. They are. And the old woman was looking for something under the street light, and the young man came along, and he said, "Ma'am, can you ask something? Can I help you?" And she said, "Yes, son, I lost my needle. I was stitching something, sewing something, and I lost my needle, and I am looking for it." He said, "May I help you?" He said, "Certainly, son." So he also began to look for it. After a while, they went around there. He said, "Do you know exactly where you got the needle?" He said, "Yeah, I got it in my house." He said, "But why are you looking for it out in the street?" He said, "Because there is no dark inside." We laugh at this story, and that's what we are doing. Everything tells us consciousness, the secret, the treasure is inside. But we want to go out and look for it somewhere outside, because when we close our eyes, it's dark inside. We want to study why it's dark inside. Does it have to be dark inside? Why is it dark inside? When we close our eyes, why is it dark? Has anybody asked this question to answer? I close my eyes, why does it become dark? Many many people say, this is the right question. The answer is, and that's the beginning of the question. They said, why is it bad when it grows on rice? They said, it is bad because it grows on rice. But I said, I can see when I close my eyes and I think of my friends I met yesterday over coffee, I can see them. I can see the coffee table. I can see the coffee. How can I see that? I said, maybe you can see some memories. Maybe you can imagine things. I said, I can imagine better than the darkness. How can darkness is more useful to better than Isaac? But all I can see is where the light comes from. Can I see the sun shining when my eyes are closed? I said, why can't you imagine? And the sun can be shining. I said, well, if you close your eyes and imagine that you don't think that the sun is shining, it's cool. Struggling, the same spirit of magic can be seen. Why is that there? I'm exposed. Where are you seeing that? Oh, that's imagination. Where is imagination? Where does it come from? From the same consciousness inside. Have you examined this? What is imagination? Some people say, imagination is unreal. Unreal in relation to what? Unreal in relation to what we can see outside with our senses. Therefore, we are ordered in this prayer that the only reality is the world inside, and the only pursuit which is real is the worldly pursuit with things that is of a sensory meaning, and that everything else must be imaginary and unreal. That is why we ignore any pursuit towards consciousness itself, but we put our attention on things that would be seen with the senses, experienced through the senses, and would be tested out from their reality and separated from imagination. I once to give an interesting experiment to some friends of mine. I said, if you sitting on that chair and you imagine that you are sitting on this table, and you don't, they said yes. I said, how intense is your concentration on this? They said, we can concentrate as much as we like because we have a lot of meditation. In the Boston Yoga Center at the end of the 60s. I saw my next try out. You sit there in the physical body and imagine you're sitting on this table. And let's see what happens. And they were like, that's what I'm imagining. And I said, are you there or here? They said, we are there, but imagine we are here. So which one is real? That's real. This is imagination. I said, do you know what? They said, this is imagination. It's because we can be here there. I said, no, keep on concentrating that you are there. At a certain point, they said they were here. Why are you? And why are you there? That it happened before, never happened before. It had never happened before. And a little proof of the items maybe came up from their personal experience that we are here. And we take this already in this room as real because of the amount of attention we are giving to this. If we give an equal amount of attention to what we imagine that they are here, in fact, when the attention is split between two positions, one we are taking as real and one we are taking as imaginary, and the attention on what we take as imaginary becomes 59% of the amount of available attention that they are real with the fire. This is the nature of imagination. You have it done it. I once tried another experiment, also here, when I was at home. And that was to make a person understand that we are so much in every single level, we forgotten where we are coming from. We are only getting to know this outside world. So I put a pencil. A pen. I said, there's a pen. I have a pen. Here's a pen, and I put the pen here, and held it steady, and I said, now you look at the pen with your eyes. And as you look at the pen, I said, can you see from where you are looking at the pen? I said, from my eyes. I said, are you sure? Which eye? He said, both eyes. That's why I see the distance from the pen. I said, that means your eyes are
I should use. I do decide to focus them on the pen. Where is the eye they are looking for? He said, looks like it's in the way. Looks like I close my eyes, the pen is there, I know that you're looking for the windows on the eyes in the body, and that is looking for seeing the pen, and the pen becomes what it is behind the eyes inside. He said, look closely. Where is the eye? Close your eyes, come into the pen. We can see three things. You, the pen, and seeing. Can you see these three things? Took a long time. Took a long time, even for an experimental human movie, to see that when we look at a pen, there are three things. When you look at a pen, you think there is only one thing, the pen. When you look at anything, that's the only thing you can look at. But in that experiment, I said, there's a pen. Are you carrying a pen? Yes. Are you aware that you're still looking at it from a distance? Yes. Are you aware that between the pen and you is a link or a hook? Through the eyes? He said, yes. I said, can you move your attention along this axis, the axis that takes you from yourself to the pen to the hand of the hook? He said, I can. He said, yes. Is it a pen? I am conscious that I am looking at the pen, but I cannot move around this axis. I said, looking at the pen is different method. So I took that piece of paper. As I was looking intensely at the pen, I took up my paper and dropped it. Said, is the pen there? I said, no, go back to where you are. And in an instant, in that very instant, he was plain in the light of the kind he had ever seen before. So I am amazed that something happens so suddenly. I was filled with light. I said, where did this light come from? We didn't light up any bulbs or anything. The light came out with a simple experiment of drawing attention to myself. The self that was watching the pen, letting the light into its invisible form, and let it back to the self in some way. I am recalling these few experiments to remind you that we are not fully aware of what's going on behind the eyes. We are conscious of what's happening in front of the eyes, and we are conscious of what's going on in this world. So, whatever pursuits have taken over most of our attention and time because we are not conscious of where we attend to our worldly pursuits. But if you don't want to use a pen for this thing, you just want to go. Who are we? Why? Who is it that is engaging in these worldly pursuits? Number one, if we just want to have an idea of that, we can withdraw the attention behind the eyes in a very simple way and get an idea who is involved in the worldly pursuit. In other words, we go back to the old question which has been asked again and again, no one has said, find out who is himself, find out is there an individual self within the story that is having this worldly experience. If we can withdraw our attention to the self, he would say that is all spiritual pursuit. A spiritual pursuit is to look at the experience, and worldly pursuit is to look at the experience. That we have an experience, the one who is having the experience sitting inside, and to know who we are is to know who the experience is. That's a spiritual pursuit. And to know what the experience is, which the experience is having, is to know something. Is to have a worldly pursuit. That these two are different directions. That either we put our attention outside, in which case we are engaged in worldly pursuits, or we are directing attention to our own self and find the truth there, which is a spiritual pursuit. There is a good case made out for the title of today's presentation, worldly pursuits versus spiritual pursuits, that this depends upon the direction of attention. If our attention always flows outside, we are engaged in worldly pursuits. If our attention always flows within, we are engaged in spiritual pursuits. A spiritual pursuit is to find the truth of who we are, why we are here, why this pattern is set up, what is the layout that must be made, why are we given a certain kind of experience. Sometimes a very strange thing has happened to people who have tried to form the spiritual pursuit. That means, those who are trying to withdraw their attention to themselves, they suddenly got kicked off into a new kind of commitment, as if they woke up from a dream. audience and they join the festival, and it's more hype. And our music they hear, they get an experience as if they have woken up into a different kind of world. As if the world they woke up from was being created out of the world to which they live. They liken it sometimes to waking up from a general dream. If you are sleeping at night, having a dream, the dream looks very real. If you wake up from a dream, get up from a dream, suddenly you find the dream wasn't there, you created it. But the dream has the same characters, the same people that you dream in real life. And the dream sequence took place because of what was happening in real life. And the real life determines what we know in a dream. For example, he has a stronger voice than I have. He can shout at me. He has a strong voice. So we keep him quiet like you and they're calling him. He can tell you the things. But his strong voice, he can use on me and intimidate me while I'm here. Supposing he did so. Supposing he shouted at me and I'm intimidated, I won't shout back at him. I am very likely at night to have a dream. In dream, I will see him and I will be shouting back at him. And he can do it anyway. How did that dream sequence come? How did it get the dream? How did it get the role in the dream for what happened on the sequence day? So the way it was established, why is really responsible for the sequences that took place in the dream? If that is so, is it possible? And can we verify that what is happening to us here? Why are we having relationships? Why are we come across people? Why are we come across certain incidents? Why are we get our hair all the time? Why are we playing this game of proving? In this life, in this world, is because of what happened in some other frequency. Is it possible that this is just a dream-like existence which is arising? Happen is arising because of what happened in the moon frequency. Is it possible to verify? The answer is, it is possible to verify if you can wake up at very less stage. If you can wake up, there is no way to know. You can only guess. If you guess, you can say, maybe there are some problems for it, but if you can wake up deliberately at will, then there is a possibility that you can find out why you are doing this on your head. You understand exactly what's going on here. If you can find out what's going on in one medical state. So the secret of this would be to pick up something in our consciousness that makes us experience a more medical state. This experiment does not possible to do, anybody can do. No matter the technique, which experiment has demonstrated this, the technique of drawing attention back to the experience of and experience. The technique of knowing who we are rather than what we are experiencing. If we can only this technique of going back to where we are operating from, within the head, within the water, within this physical body, in the brain center, if we can find out where we are looking out from, where we are experiencing, where the emotion comes, the feelings, the intuitions, we are actually experiencing a running problem. If we can just put our attention there, we might wake up to a higher level of consciousness. And that gives all the answers. Without specifically asking each question getting an answer, then we wake up, we go where we are, we don't ask specific questions. And if there's this factor that we wake up in the morning after a dream, when we wake up, we never pinch ourselves to see the other way. We never call anybody, I don't know how to verify if I'm awake. If people came to us and on the bedside and we wake up in the morning, they say, no, you're still breathing, you're sleeping. We don't believe it. We don't accept it because we know the truth. The truth is we are awake. Then we are breathing, somebody says you are awake, we can't believe it. Maybe we are, maybe it's a dream, maybe we are awake. We question this. But when we actually wake up, the awakening process carries with it its own certainty. And therefore, we are going to come out. In fact, there are very few things in human life that we can actually raise with them. And this is one of them. That when we wake up, we are actually raised with them normally. Something strange happens. Every morning. Every morning that we wake up, we are very, very confused. We never do this experiment on ourselves to What actually happens is something in consciousness. The stream of experiences from the previous night, very little stream, comes back. That's what makes us be so sure we are awake. Did you notice that? In the morning when we wake up, we remember. We are awake. We are asleep. That's why the wakeful experience is an absolutely certain experience. If there can be another wakeful experience of that kind, which means it is not something we see beautiful sky and we fly and we have music and the stars and we have wonderful dreams. That's not wakefulness. People are coming in this very vicinity, in my time, university professors coming, veterans, Mexican restaurants, LSD, all kinds of things that we need to establish wakeful states. That's very convenient. That when you have extraordinary experiences, they did not get certainty of the awake. They got the certainty of the new experience, but they did not require wisdom to the golden embassy. On the other hand, every moment that we wake up now, we are certainly in the embassy, and that is why it's certainly awake. If we did not indulge in earth kickoffs based upon the energy centers in our body, if we did not spend the golden mind, opening of the heart chakra, opening of the throat chakra, opening of the brain chakra, any energy chakra. If we do not take our extraordinary experiences to be chakras, but get it merely by giving ourselves behind the eyes, then we will get the experience of wakefulness of the kind which we get every morning. That means wakefulness to the spirit of life, which is so real, because we are so there. We know. Instantly, when we get there, we know instantly that we went through this so called waking experience of this world because we had been there early. It doesn't happen. It's not about wakefulness. We are awake enough, it doesn't happen. But what if it happens? If it happens, it explains everything. It gives all the answers to the questions of why we are here, what kind of things we are doing when we pursue, what is the creation. Being engrossed in what we pursue and yet trying to get away from it. Why are we alone? You can ask this question. In this moment, if we did not have any notion of why we came and why we are what we are, if we cannot wake up any further, and this is it, this is the final state of wakefulness, this is the final state of consciousness, then it is a true question why are we really feeling lonely? That should be an answer. Why are we feeling lonely? What are we doing? We have a home. We have relationships. We have people for us. We have things for us. We have everything to keep us busy in this world. Even in the busiest crowd, we need only. What feels lonely of? What feels lonely is that part of consciousness which is going to take. But we are going to take the loneliness to only have that loneliness. It is not overcome. This world has not been able to overcome our loneliness. Even though we try so hard, we care. We try to help people. We try to understand people. We try to communicate with people. What happens? There's some missing link somewhere. If we really we have come to know somebody and we can communicate, it may last a month, 2 months, 6 months, year after that, it changes. What happens to the communication link? Today we say, we are all so away, we understand you suddenly. And after some time, we understand the disappears, there is no communication. That our connections are not escaping. Don't we have these experiences over time? Why? Because we are all on the floor. Why, in the midst of so much company, we should be lonely? It's only if we get awakened to that state that we can find that our having to go through this entire experience is based upon earlier experience through which loneliness was created. But it is necessary to understand the nature of our experiences here and the loneliness that we experience even in the weekly pursuits to awaken. So I am suggesting that although the direction of attention going outside is the direction for weekly pursuits, and the reverse of this direction to go inside or to awaken to a higher level of consciousness is a spiritual pursuit, it is good for us to use or sitting on that company yard outside, I spilled the soup today. You understand that? Why is it necessary to have this spilled silver soup? I am a moment you are in the soup house. But if they are not on it, I have seen many people running economies, districts, farmers, masters. They are running to get some light, to get some happiness. Why? Because they are not happy. Very rarely I find a person who says, I'm very happy with this world, but I'm looking for a spiritual teacher. They're looking for spiritual teachers because something is missing here, which is making them unhappy. Some people look happy from a distance. And we say, those people must be happy. We go and live with them for 3 days, then we find out they don't perform well. We just would know even a little more. So many of us are trying to put on a mask with a smile. We are funny. And if somebody wants to really come to know, they know the skin, we start breaking down in time. But we then find how unhappy we are. In this world, it is the ugliness of this world, the suffering of this world, the unappreciation of this world, the injustice and the iniquity of this world, the blindness of this world, and all the other things that people are negative, that this world sent us to see. And how can we approach it? If we didn't have these negativities here, we would look for the spirit to pursue at all. So, in a way, a strange thing is happening that the misery of this world, the unhappiness of this world, is making us to find happiness of it, which is within ourselves. And we look from that common sense, and we can find the other way around. Maybe we can find somebody who can say, look, don't come along. If this very world is the same pursuit in the way, hold it in your own self. This true spiritual pursuit is to find your own awakened self, to go within your own self. And then we can visit. We get a clue. That's why we were unhappy, because we did not know what was going on. So that knowledge helps. Once we kick off that knowledge, the same item goes back, and then you look at the world, it becomes zero. Every time we go in, it comes, the world becomes zero. Every time we have knowledge of our own self within, and then come and follow this great pursuit, it makes it so easy, and the happiness starts giving happiness. So who is the happiest person you can find is the one who proves the misery and unhappiness of this world, and as I said, and go back to the many pursuits, use the happiness, and give this world also happiness. So then, these two work in unison with each other. The misery of this world makes for the spiritual of this world to pursue. The achievement of the spiritual pursuit makes us look at the worldly pursuit in a different way and starts giving happiness in the worldly pursuits. So eventually, both of them become a source of happiness. So the happiest people are those who are following their worldly pursuits after having achieved success in the spiritual pursuit. The happiest people on this earth, you wouldn't have been. Look at people who are really happy. And you can find the ratio of their time. We need our help so many. But those who are always happy, we will find that those who have combined the quality of truth with the knowledge and awareness gained from this principle. Those who have had the chance to go with them, see who they are, they are born like in the outside and inside of us. So the combination is the best thing. What about those who say, if we have the happiness inside, why should we come out? They are not happy. One mystic, one master, gave a good example. He said, seekers are peacocks. Some seek happiness in this world. They are like a honeybee who doesn't want to work hard to collect the honey from flower to flower, but finding a pot of honey and a pond place, comes through and jumps into the river, and all its brings us here. And comes to that and says, why not anymore? And says, oh, can I play in there? I don't even get enough time to taste the honey. And speak with it, and I mean, these kinds of people who pursue happiness to the source are those who believe this world is special, that it can offer all the pleasure of the world up here. Let's go and enjoy ourselves in a very good time. And they go and I deep into this world, and then they are constant passions. How about the misery of the world? They can't get them. They are so tied up. They say, it's terrible, even though we got
don't agree with this, we are end of the day disappointed. And the first step, the secret God, was not our habits. The second time you were restored, all these ascetics, the yogis, looking to the mountains, and see the condition on the place for. Then the idea, the second time that she says, oh, you must tell me the idea of the phenomenon. That is terrible. Look at what happened to this one. Look at these many people, until they got divorced, they were pleasant of the world, and thought nothing of unhappiness for themselves. I better give up here. So I should hide in the forest, in the mountains, in the different places, and take a stand there. They go into the Himalayas, and they go into deep forest, and they go into the cave of civilization, and they find this constantly in war and hope, and they put there. So they are very unhappy. Things they don't. It's like a baby who said, I don't want to have experience on the other one, so I'm going to go ahead and come together again to see the whole honey. And if I don't enjoy the honey, no one enjoys it, it's quite grateful. This is the second category of seekers who want to keep away from the world and renounce it because it is so tempting. It is so lonely as people would be lost. But they also say, the third category of the honeybee is the one that real seekers should be like. The category of honeybee looks at the condition of these two. One got drawn in the honey, the other got bearded, and finds the real way of coming intelligently. One just sits on the edge of the cup, draws the honey, and buys it. Who are these? What kind of honeybee is there that comes and sits on the edge of the cup of honey and finally, those are the seekers who come enjoy this world without getting attached to it. Those who come and sit on the edge of this world, they are this world, this dimension, this pursuit we are having here, is not the real way. We just come to taste it, to decide it, and then go away. Only those seekers of this time who have experienced what the pursuit of this world and get it out of the same so far, and the pursuit of spirituality, because they can find it, and it is because they can find it. And they want to. Those are the kinds of seekers who are experimenting in both. This is why worldly pursuit should be covered with the spiritual pursuit which enables us to sit at the edge of this universe, edge of this world, enjoy this world, and fly away. This will try. This is the real goal. This is the road which, if you have in different categories of people who are following, right? Spiritual and religious life. This will be the kingdom of spirituality and the kingdom of the world because they know where to stop in the pursuit of this world, in the pursuit of enjoyment of this world, and where to fly off in the world. It is not possible to live this kind of a life on the third day, which is on the edge, and then fly on the right, unless you have the riches. What are the dangers of the enjoyment of this world? And the possibility of planning this country and you know. That's only possible if we in our lifetime, while we are here, we are able to move our attention to a place. Attention going to the body of the suits here, and attention going inside of the suit to our spirituality, to the reality within ourselves. Those who practice worship are the happiest people. Those who love our leader are the happy. Now you go around and look at the world. I've traveled a lot of people, you must have traveled and seen all of your friends and associates. See, this is true. See, this is the true test of happiness. Both in this world and in the spiritual world, that those of the maximum happiness who have the facility to put their attention on this and there at will. So, this kind of an experiment is to with consciousness of being able to switch attention within himself or both. Then, life makes for the best happiness. Possible in this world. So, we need to learn both. We already learned how to learn one part. We learned how to go to this world. So, we try to learn anymore. We learn it every day. So, we only need to balance it by learning a little bit of how to go there. If we learn how to put our attention behind the eyes, then we have the second part. And then we come back to the world. We have the ultimate habits of this world and the other world. We also get answers to all the questions. This particular statement I made, that if you have access to the awakening state inside, awareness builds up in you, and you get to look on things as if they're nowhere. They're not from nowhere, they're inside. That's why they have even an awareness level. They are coming, that awareness is coming from the head because of the movement created in. The movement moves our eyes and moves our own sight. And out of the pencil and outside, what we may be looking at the head as the fact. The fact behind the eyes, from where we look at all things, from where we think, from where we are aware, from where we are conscious, where intuition operates, where all conscious functions operate. The fact which has been referred to as a third eye, at the center, at the center of vision, at the center of existence, the center of consciousness, that body, if we only have that, and bring your attention this way and that way and there, the more you bring your attention this way, the more your awareness grows, and the more you know things. So then you only have worthy pursuits out of that kind of experience. Straight things up. This is again experiment. And I'm not in trouble. I would suggest you try this experiment of spending time with drawing attention to yourself every morning for your life, for 1 week. And then go out and see who you are not going to suit and see your life is taken. It's a very simple experiment. You don't need to find out. If you find that people are smiling at you more than before, are less mad at you than before, and things are looking better than people are behaving really for you, something that. Not only that, if you find an uncanny thing called a coincidence, that's strange happening in central density, where things happen in such a way as if to give a message. If you find that the more you put it in, the more the number of coincidences have started happening, which is giving you happiness outside, based on the taking place, you should get there between the inner environment, from yourself, and the outward pursuit of happiness in the world. I have found it over and again with experimenters around the world. No particular culture has an advantage over the other. It may, because of knowledge of special terms and so on, but I experience so there is no particular advantage anybody has by nationality, by color, by age, by sex in this matter. That the quality of life changes outside. And as you take a breath inside, you do your own consciousness. Every time you take a breath, you come back, you face the people. But if you don't take a breath inside, it's just a book of soul. What is inside? Let me step away. Let me put it intellectually. And I ask a man, what am I doing? That doesn't change. It is not the intellect. It is not the thinking machine that will change the experience outside. It is not like I was suggesting that you will change the circumstance of this world. But it is by the power of awareness that you are against. Of course, later on you will find to your immense surprise that it was the power of awareness that set up this dream that will make this state in the first place. In this case, you understand exactly why this happened. You understand exactly when you put your attention inside and the whole world changes outside, why is it? It is because the whole world came to be from the power of consciousness which is inside. It doesn't look appealing now because we are relying upon the senses and the eye. Sense perceptions in order to determine the reality of this world. When that happens, we can only go by some subjective experiences and say, we are getting better, people are getting better, that's what happens. I have talked to people in even a week, 10 days, often. Every time I talk to them again, they find happiness. So it's a gradual process of getting more and more happiness. In all the pursuits among the spiritual pursuits. Then what happens? Suppose you get flexible about it. You can switch on. Okay, now I'm going to take a little trip, a little dip into my rest of my life, of awareness. Early morning, I'm taking a little extra energy from my reservoir of awareness. And now I'm going to be with my day-to-day world. Okay, day-to-day world is tight. Let me have a little. Quick, refreshing, deep in the reservoir. In fact, suppose that you develop this kind of flexibility of going within and dealing with the worldly problems at will. Then what will happen? You will find you don't have to make a difference in and out of the world. Then it becomes natural. That why are you going to have any pursuits? You don't have to go there, you don't have to go there, and then it automatically changes your
not blame them for acting outside with the same sense of the place. I'll tell you what, how is it? And if you get to this vicinity, and also going with them and coming out, and after when you find the migrant who are all together, they are both happening together. People are sometimes asking, is it necessary to close one's eyes to the practice? That is in the beginning, yes. Because if you don't close your eyes, you look at the same things, going back into the heart, in the deeper stages. There's no difficulty at all in doing meditation with your eyes open. There's no difficulty at all in doing meditation by walking away with your heart. Because meditation is not putting yourself in a certain posture and standing upside down on the head. Meditation is being aware of your strength at the center behind your head. You can be there right now. You can be aware while driving, by walking, talking, doing your work. You have to be aware where you're doing this for now. If that is your understanding, that is what we are trying to achieve by closing our eyes. When we close our eyes and meditate, when we get into a particular posture, instead of being able to draw our attention from other actions, we are trying to become aware of what's happening at the third eye center. Once you become aware, it becomes a way of life, it becomes a constant meditation. Then we can be always working the soul's center sitting by a spiritual person. Become protagonists. So, it is a phase of development. As we grow into greater and greater awareness of our own self, we spiritual pursuits and body pursuits begin to hold back. Whether it be we get on, happy life, and people wonder, how can you be happy all the time? If I ask this question, how can you be happy all the time? I say, I can't say, how I'm happy all the time. I'm happy all the time. We never cause for that. Maybe there is, but I don't know. Maybe we need to come properly. Why is that should be on that? But if that thing comes, no wonder why is that thing happy? Since that we never say. There's unhappiness in everything. Nothing seems to work. Nothing seems to go the right way. People don't understand it. And what man said, things don't happen the way you want. And when the other situation states yes, everything will go according to plan. Why do things don't go according to plan? That is spiritual pursuit. And why does it start going according to plan? After developing the exploiting in spiritual pursuit, the reason is that when you have the awareness in spiritual development, you are aware of the plan. If you are aware of the plan, you will understand where you are the plan is going. The plan for our life in this world is a good plan. Why not we do good work? Why do we do it? We don't know what the plan is. We try to make our own plans. And sometimes it conflicts with the plan that already exists or which we are using. And so we are conflict. Look at this. How in our own life we have had to make several decisions and then say, I wish I had more on this. I wish I had understood on here. I wish I had listened to my intuition first. I wish I had acted on my gut knowledge. I wish I had listened to so and so. I wish I had heard the message that came to me at that time. I wish I had listened to somebody. Why do we have to say all that? Because of the ignorance of the plan. And what happens in spiritual development? But many times we know it's a good plan, one likes it, and then one is always living according to the plan. This is not it. But then one has to say, I wish I had done something else because you know exactly what it was. This is one of the big stories of what happens. That if you can discover the plan already existing, then you can have happiness in the worldly pursuits, whatever pursuits you do. What about the internet? What about the situation in which we are now? We want to get to the plan, we don't know the plan yet, we are very worldly pursuits, and we are trying to make our decisions, we don't want to calculate from the plan, but we don't know what the plan is. Can we do something available yet? Is there something we can do to cause for as well as we can to the plan without messing it up with our own decisions? Can we really get to the plan of the plan? Is there some intended way to do it? The answer is yes. Understand the nature of the plan, how it operates, and it is a language which can be built in the area of the plan and make your decisions for it.
some people call it living in the will of God. They say, you live in this will, you are not God. You mess it up when you try to interfere with the will that is living in you. Some people say that when Jesus spoke of the alignment of the will, he is talking of the law of the will. His will in the will. That will, which is created by you, being created on others in the will. And if we know that will, we might move on. How do we want to know that will? One Muslim answered this question. He said, people ask me this question over and over again. How do you know what is this will? And I feel it's such a simple thing to know. And my answer is, when he has given a spade in your hand, he has expressed it his will. Him. That means if the Creator has put us, whatever are you getting it? Put us into certain circumstances and conditions in which we have to act in a certain way, he has expressed his will after that way. Now, if we act that way, according to circumstances and coincidences that happen around us, things are much simpler and happier. And if we try to interfere with it and say, no, I don't want that, I want to have something else. There are some indications which we sometimes call the language of God, as against the language of our own mind. The intelligent mind is trying to plan for very little knowledge it has, in contrast to the perfect will of the Lord, of the Creator, that tells us what we should do. And we try to listen to the mind that comes into contact with that will. How can we avoid it? By listening to the language of the Creator, which is positive, and answer the why, ignoring the mental direction which is taking us in a negative way. How do we read that language? The language comes in the form of a wrong mental intuition. That's how it happens. Listen to it. Not the second hand, but the first. I have to explain this because people get the seven hands and they say, no, let me speak again. The mind wants to change it. Also, the mind wants to create its own intuition and says, I always go by my intuition. Let me see, I have to go tomorrow, after tomorrow, I have to go. I'm going to go beyond the time that the mind needed to make an intuition. That's not intuition. Intuition doesn't come when you bank for it and you ask for it. Intuition comes when you expect it. The unexpected fact knowledge that comes that comes is reliable. That's the goal. That's true. In your own life, that unexpected, unused intuition which comes suddenly when you don't expect it, you don't want it. Gives you a message, I ignore it, and that comes, trust that. The second thing we trust is the coincidences that happen in circumstances also. Trust that. Put these two things together and make your decisions, you can live in that way, which you can get after awakening to a higher level of consciousness. Therefore, we have an intuition which is not wrong. Therefore, we should awaken to a higher level of consciousness and not know what kind of decisions we should take. What kind of life we should lead in order to get the maximum happiness here that we have this way, live by your intuition, live by coincidences and circumstances, what we are saying, and then use the mind, which is the right against this once in a while. Tell the mind, look, you might take as hard as you like, I'm going to do that, now you tell me how to do it. Use the mind, how to do it, not what to do. Most of the time, we use the mind on what to do. That's all. We should ask the mind how to do it. What to do should depend upon the recognition of the will. What to do should depend upon the circumstances that arise. What to do should come to us from that intuition inside. How to do it should come from the mind. Get the mind work. Get the card. I can call it to do it. That's the legitimate job of the mind. Use the thinking process for its legitimate job on finding out how to do it from the mind. We do that, then we find that we have already an awareness still there on the contrary. The thing we have only experience of spiritual awakening, which we can call it and experiment with. Isn't that strange? At least we have means to test out this particular experimental result that these people in consciousness have shared with us, that we can test out whether it changes the quality of our life or not. And I have come here just to share
this with you, that if we are beginning to see the two directions, the direction within, which is the direction for spiritual pursuits, the direction outside, which is the direction for worldly pursuits, the use of both these in Buddhism, ultimately making it one and getting to a higher state by putting our attention at the primary center, if we can get there to this way and to the final sense and give us happiness, it's all right. We don't have to change our aims, our idols, our religion, our education, our parents, our brother, sister. We have to change nothing at all. All we have to change is our attitude towards openness with our own self. Of being able to look at our own selves within rather than always looking at things outside. And then this experience comes to us. It's both from coming out, where the combination of information and coincidence is a good guide for us. And if it works for a while, right from all of you, if it doesn't, you have my friends over decades whom I have taught have not given it up, they are adopting it more and more. Coincidences and the wind that comes through coincidences, you know, it's the people that most probably make decisions and they use a thinking mind carrying it out. This way they have been able to achieve happiness of high level in their worldly pursuits as well as in their spiritual pursuits. So, when I started by separating the two and I thought the title really wanted me to expound on the distinction between worldly pursuits and spiritual pursuits, I had ended up by saying the two can be combined. Give us happiness in both directions. Thank you very much. Any questions? Any questions? I think we're very happy to answer. Questions or comments or answers? I'm very glad for the first time about this opportunity to Alan's organization. It's very good to draw people out here. They're here to help us today. Not come here before, except in another capacity. So I hope this friendship we meet today will continue. We have more opportunities to be here on. And we have a chance to discuss things more on an ongoing basis or smaller group basis, so that we understand any clarifications needed. Some of these things we talk about, like what exactly is meant by. What are the hindrances to it? How can we overcome those hindrances? There are many small matters of detail that we can all discuss. Overcome the problems that are impacting the life of habits. And no questions? It means either what Mr. Wally said or Mr. Wally. Thank you very much.